There is a guy who I'm very pleased to welcome to the show, and we've been hoping to have him on for a while. His name is Lee Goodman. He is the chairman of the Federal Election Commission. And people don't pay that much attention to the FEC, but they should, because Chairman Goodman is fighting a fairly lonely but very heroic battle, it seems to me, to stop his colleagues from cracking down on your right to post blogs or political messages for free, not paid, for free on the Internet. Chairman Goodman, first of all, thanks for your work and thanks for coming on. And what is it that your colleagues exactly are trying to do?
Well, Michael, thank you for having me on your show. I've been a fan of yours for a long time, and I'm a fellow movie file, so hopefully we can talk about some of the implications of this issue for political films and other political formats as well. We had a case recently at the Federal Election Commission that we made public involving a group called Checks and Balances for Economic Growth, and the allegation was that Checks and Balances for Economic Growth had apparently run some videos on television critical of a certain political figure in the 2012 election. And Checks and Balances proved to the commission that they had not paid any fee at all to run these videos on television. Instead, they had posted these videos for free on YouTube.com, and that's the only dissemination of these two videos that were at issue. Now, our Office of General Counsel looked at it and analyzed what Checks and Balances had done as exempt from our regulation under a 2006 regulation. In 2006, the commission considered what to do about all this Internet communication about politics and decided that the commission would regulate for-fee advertising on the Internet and political committees. When they post websites and other commentary online, they have to put disclaimers on their communications online. But for citizens and groups and organizations that are posting information and political commentary online for free, YouTube, your own website, your own blog, your own podcast, whatever that format may be, we don't regulate you at the Federal Election Commission because there's no expenditure or measurable expenditure associated with that dissemination or that disseminated message.
Yeah, one of the things that I'm thinking of here is people, I think, are hearing for the first time, wait a minute, the Federal Elections Commission is going to regulate what I post on the Internet? I mean, the last I checked, the regulators and censors had not done a terrific job of regulating pornography on the Internet. But we're going to crack down on political expressions. Now, to be fair, the Checks and Balances group that in Ohio that you were supposed to be looking at for potential regulation, would it be fair to say that this was an anti-Obama group?
The video posts that they made on YouTube were critical of the president and his position on coal.
Oh, no.
And I'm here talking about the greater danger of what we did with Checks and Balances, but that case broke 3-3. My two colleagues, you were kind to say that I'm fighting a lonely battle. I can tell you I have two stalwarts here at the Federal Election Commission, Commissioner Matt Peterson and Commissioner Caroline Hunter. They are my two Republican colleagues on the commission, and we come in and we fight for the First Amendment whenever and wherever we can here at the commission. We voted to dismiss this case. We voted to free Checks and Balances under the 2006 regulation and free their YouTube posts from any inquiry or regulation by the Federal Election Commission. But we surprisingly ran into a 3-3 vote. We are a six-member commission. It requires four votes to enforce the law against an organization, so the case went away. But when you have a 3-3 vote in a case involving two free YouTube.com video posts,
okay, well, if we can just back up for a minute.
Shadow.
It is very chilling because let's say that you hadn't gotten that third vote. Let's say the vote had gone 4-2, not 3-3, and the 4-2 had been in favor of regulating these YouTube videos that are posted. What would have happened to this group?
This group would have then become the subject of subpoenas, intrusive investigation into their entire organization, all other communications that they made. They would have had to have incurred legal fees in responding to the compulsory process of the Federal Election Commission, and it eventually would have come back to the commission for another vote, what we call a probable cause to believe vote, and they could have faced, assuming that there were four votes on this commission to regulate them, they could have faced serious fines.
And of course, if you don't pay the fines, you go to jail.
If you don't pay the civil fines, you do not go to jail. However, if the Department of Justice determines that what you did was knowing and willful, they can prosecute you criminally for a violation of the Federal Election Campaign Act.
This is astonishing. I mean, we are frequent guest on this show, and a friend of mine is Dinesh D'Souza, who has been sort of living under what they call supervision. I mean, he basically, every time he has to relieve himself, he has to get approval from a judge. I mean, it's pretty much that, because he gave more money than was approved to a friend of his from college for her Senate campaign. But back to this. This is so astonishing to folks because, I mean, one of the good things about the internet is it's pretty lively. There's not a shortage of opinion on all sides. What is the excuse for trying to regulate free content on the internet?
I don't think there is an excuse, Michael, but I can read to you because in addition to having the 3-3 vote, one commissioner who voted to enforce the law against checks and balances for its YouTube post issued a statement explaining this 3-3 split. And that was our vice chair, Ann Ravel. And I'm reading from a statement that's on our website, and it's a public document. And she says today, and I'm reading from her statement, today the commission publicly released the file in an enforcement matter concerning the disclosure and disclaimer requirements for certain internet advertisements. The commission here deadlocked on whether there should be any reporting for particular political advertisements disseminated only online. She went on to say that the commission has not adapted with changes in technology and has failed to acknowledge the importance of providing transparency to the public, no matter what the medium of political communication, and she called for a reexamination of the commission's 2006 regulation. And I believe the way we have interpreted that, I think, is quite fairly, is that what Commissioner Ravel would like to see is a regulatory system of disclaimers and public reports every time you post political commentary on the internet. As you just mentioned, I mean, the American people have become accustomed to discussing politics online at low cost, often no cost at all, or the low cost of a personal computer and a monthly internet connection charge. And the internet is probably the most democratic medium of communication, you know, ever invented. It's empowered hundreds of thousands of populist voices and viewpoints across the spectrum of ideology. And I can't imagine the deterrence effect if the federal government were to begin imposing a disclosure regime every time you want to blog about politics.
And when you say a disclosure regime, what that would mean would be, how long were the videos from Checks and Balances? They were short, weren't they?
I believe they were probably a minute or two, maybe three or four, you know, between 1 and 4 minute videos.
And then for these free videos that people accessed for free, that were posted for free, they didn't pay any money to post, they put them up on YouTube, what would they have to have this message brought to you by?
I can't speak for Commissioner Ravel precisely on what she expected to see, but generally, yes, I assume that the implication is that they would have to tell you who they are, who paid for the videos, and then possibly even have to file expenditure reports with the Federal Election Commission.
Okay, where do we go from here? We will be right back with Lee Goodman. He's chairman of the Federal Elections Commission. And if you think it's a good idea to regulate content more on the internet, there are many things on the Michael Medved Show that I find almost incomprehensible about the so-called progressive mindset. But one of them is the belief that government is necessary to organize, regulate, supervise all kinds of areas of human endeavor that seem to be working pretty decently. And you see this constantly. There is just this compulsion to expand government power and to regulate people's lives. And right now there's a fight going on at the FEC, the Federal Elections Commission, by people who want to regulate free content on the Internet. Now, we're speaking to the chairman of the FEC, who has been fighting this government power grab, and that's what it is. His name is Lee Goodman, 1-800-955-1776. Before we continue the conversation, there are folks who are calling in wanting to know how they can get their voices heard on this issue. And the best way to do that is to go right to it's www.federalelectionscommission or FEC.gov. Is that right, Lee?
Right. Yes, FEC.gov, www.FEC.gov. And look for either go to my homepage at the FEC's website, or on the front page you will see a section where the FEC is seeking public comment on the McCutcheon decision, and you can log right there online and submit your comments on this issue.
Okay, what I don't fully understand, and this goes to bigger issues like the whole desire to, quote, limit money in politics, but this is not money. This is free content. And what we're talking about, because if people buy ads on the Internet, and some people do, that's already regulated, right?
That's already regulated. You made a good point. You know, the FEC was created to regulate large contributions and large expenditures in elections, not speech itself. And what's so beautiful about the Internet and the World Wide Web is speech there is virtually free or low cost. It is non-corruptive. And any American, and hundreds of thousands of Americans do, go online and post their commentary about politics. Not only do they post their commentary about politics, but citizens log on the Internet and seek out the commentary they want to read on the Internet. The government does not need to get involved in that exchange of ideas.
Let's go to your calls and our ongoing exchange of ideas. Randy in Dallas, Georgia, you're on the Medved Show.
Hi, Michael. Much like the radio industry, it's the public airways and how the president has just recently talked about wanting to make the Internet part of public utilities, that there is a certain amount that the government should be involved.
Randy, if I can just jump in for a moment, because I was recently reading about this. If you go back to the Hoover administration, which is when they started the Federal Communications Commission, here was the idea, is we knew at the very beginning that there were a limited number of radio frequencies. In other words, right now I'm broadcasting, our flagship station is AM 770 in Seattle. Somebody can't go ahead and say, I'm going to broadcast on AM 770 because you need that frequency. You own it. There's no kind of limitation like that on the Internet. Is there, Chairman Goodman?
No. Anybody with an Internet connection and a personal computer can log on the Internet for the very low cost. You can open up your own website, your own blog. You can join social platforms and social media and other communities that create online.
And there's no limit.
This is not a rationed forum for communication.
So that's the difference, Randy, is that this whole theme of the public airwaves, it's because the federal government regulates the medium to make sure you don't have a bunch of people broadcasting on the same frequency. But you don't need that kind of federal regulation on the Internet. Appreciate your call. Let's go to Rick in Long Beach, California. Rick, you're on the Medved Show with Chairman Lee Goodman.
Hey, good afternoon, guys. I have a quandary. I'm on both sides of this issue, but I think there should be some form of regulation. Like, for example, I'm banned from the Huffington Post because I'm a conservative, pro-evangelical person, and they ban me from offensive speech, not because of foul language, but because I argue with people and I support, conservative views. So what's happened is you've allowed people to put false defamatory stuff up, or you get something like the Huffington Post, which is huge. And what they do is you know, they advocate for a political point of view at the expense of other points of views. There should be some government involvement and not just let it run wild.
Wait, Rick, let me ask you, as a conservative, why would you trust the government to rein in the Huffington Post? Why not just go to one of the conservative websites?
Well, that's a good question. I don't trust the government to regulate, but, you know, if why would we trust the government when someone robs the store? Why not solve the problem within our community?
Because the fact is, when you rob the store, there's somebody who is actually losing. And when somebody says something that you don't agree with on the Huffington Post, there's a famous law case that you learn about in law school, that where Justice Brandeis, Whitney versus California, he says the right remedy for bad speech is better speech. Chairman Goodman?
Michael, you couldn't have said it better. There are the nice thing about the Internet is if you would like to respond to the Huffington Post, you can create your own HuffingtonPostWatch.com website at very low cost, and you can counter the Huffington Post commentary on your own website. That's what's so beautiful about the democratic format that is the Internet. So I'm not one – listen, I'm just going to tell you, I'm not one to want to violate the free press rights of the Huffington Post to have their own editorial viewpoint any more than I am the Daily Caller or any other organization that may have a conservative viewpoint on the Internet. They all thrive on the Internet, and you get to go read the ones that you like. And you can also criticize the ones that you don't like on the Internet.
I appreciate your call. You had mentioned before political movies. Is there a serious attempt by the Federal Elections Commission to regulate political movies?
Well, there have been disputes within the commission, including some that have gone 3-3, about documentary films. So a nonprofit organization in 2004 called Citizens United. Does that name sound familiar to you?
It was. I appeared in the movie that was
made a documentary that was not complimentary of John Kerry. And they came to the Federal Election Commission and said, we made a film. Can we disseminate this film free of regulation by the Federal Election Commission? And the commission would not approve the free press rights of a filmmaker called Citizens United. Citizens United made a dozen, maybe 15 more films, some not having to do anything about candidates.
Okay, can you carry on with us? Do you have a time to be with us for another segment?
No, I'm happy to stay with you and we can talk about films.
Terrific. I want to get to the punchline here. I was in that Citizens United film about John Kerry. And in any event, the entire story is so bizarre. Why do liberals want to shut down free speech? We will get to that and more with Lee Goodman of the Federal Elections Commission coming up.
We need to deal with the truth.
And it's easy to figure out that there is a almost reflexive, instinctive, deep-seated, unstoppable leftist compulsion to try to regulate things. And particularly if something's working well and things are doing fine, let's nationalize it. Let's regulate it. And that appears to be the case with the Internet and even the world of documentary filmmaking. Now, it's true that 99% of documentary films that come out are very, very left-wing. They are. I get sent a whole bunch of them because I'm a voter with the Broadcast Film Critics of America, which are giving out our awards and da-da-da. So I can certify to you that there are lots and lots of left-wing documentaries. But Lee Goodman, who's the chair of the Federal Elections Commission, was talking about an attempt to regulate. Now, what? So they come out with this film, which I think was called Celsius 412 or something. Wasn't that it?
Was that the one in 2004?
Yeah, John Kerry and Michael Moore from Citizens United.
Right. Well, there was Fahrenheit 9/11.
Right, but that was Michael Moore's film.
That was Michael Moore's left-leaning editorial
that won the Oscar
against the re-election of President Bush.
Yep.
And Citizens United had a film out that was critical of John Kerry and probably his war record as well as some other issues. But let me back up, Michael. I just want to tell you, we have the Free Press Clause of the United States Constitution. And for about 60 or 70 years, the Supreme Court has recognized that moving pictures and films are entitled to, are part of the press that is protected by the Free Press Clause. This goes back to movie review boards and issues like that, you know, back in the 50s, the 1940s and 50s. Well, recognizing that a healthy democracy needs a robust media and free press rights to discuss politics, Congress, when it wrote the Federal Election Campaign Act and the amendments of 1974, put in a very explicit exemption for the press and the media. Said FEC, leave the media alone. Well, over the years, you have the two legal protections. You have the constitutional free press clause, and you have the statutory press exemption in the Federal Election Campaign Act. Well, over years, that wasn't highly debatable. The FEC tried to regulate Reader's Digest back in the 1970s, but failed because courts slapped the FEC and said, nope, you can't do that. Well, in the 2000s, what started becoming more popular were political or documentaries, editorial documentaries. And it really sort of started to bubble up in 2004 when Citizens United made this film about John Kerry. They had about four or five films to their credit at the time. And the Federal Election Commission would not exempt Citizens United from regulation by the Federal Election Commission as a press entity. Well, then after the 2004 election, there were complaints filed against Michael Moore, the Weinstein company, and for the film Fahrenheit 9/11. Remember, this was before Citizens United, the Supreme Court decision. So corporate expenditures for express advocacy, including in films, would have been prohibited at that time. So we were talking about real censorship if Citizens United or Michael Moore and the Weinstein Brothers LLC that distributed Fahrenheit 9/11 were considered to be corporate entities making express advocacy about Hillary Clinton or John Kerry or George Bush.
Now, again, there's so many films that come out
Absolutely.
That could be considered express advocacy. There was a film that came out and totally bombed in time for the election of 2012 called White House Down, where Jamie Foxx basically played Barack Obama battling an evil right-wing conspiracy led by Newt Gingrich. I mean, it was pretty clear that was what the film was supposed to be. But okay, you know, the people got the best revenge. No one went to see it.
Let's go quickly to Ken in Brooklyn. Ken, you're on the Medved Show with Chairman Lee Goodman.
Hi. Two quick questions. First, what are the mechanics of the government regulating blogs on the Internet and the possible punitive side of that? But also, do you gentlemen agree that I see a pattern of incremental erosion of personal freedoms, and it's all coming from the left? And, you know, I wouldn't compare it completely with the Nazis, but it's like the frog in the pot on the stove, that it's done incrementally, and then you wake up one day and you realize you're in a totalitarian state, you know? So do you agree that this is incrementally, we're seeing little nibbles at our personal freedoms all over the place?
I do. I would not use the Nazis as an example, but certainly it's very threatening, and I assume that you agree as well, Lee.
I do.